The first question we have to ask ourselves, why is this building here physically and politically? In 1865, the government moved from the Bay of Islands, Russell, down to Wellington, there to rent out many buildings to house the staff, civil servants. As the civil service grew, they were running out of rooms, space. So they decided, through Julius Vogel, Prime Minister, in 1874, to build this building. Now, flat land in Wellington was at a premium, so the only place they could go was out into the harbour. And in fact, this building is built on the first reclaimed land in Wellington. Across the road on the footpath is the shoreline, and that to move out about 3 acres imperial to a depth of 16 meters. And it took only 5 months to fill that in. The government was so eager to get this building up that they didn't give the land time to compact, which was to prove a problem in later years with subsidence. The building was started 1875 and was finished November 1876. Now, the building was first proposed in 1873 by Julius Vogel, but before they could commence, they needed an architect. Now, the architect was William Henry Clayton, who came from Tasmania, who had served his time in England, after which he went to Italy, where he fell in love with the Italian palaces. And later on, when he designed this building, we can see the Italian element in the building, the Italianate of the building. Henry Clayton wanted the building at first to be built in stone, but the government of the day thought it would be too expensive and, of course, earthquake prone. So he was asked to get a tender for stone and timber. The stone came in approximately, I rounded off to £40,000, and timber came in at £30,000. So timber won out. The government said, well, we'll go with timber. It's cheaper and less prone to earthquake damage. But as soon as they started, the carpenters went on strike for 2 shillings a day more. Timber went up 5 shillings in every 100 shillings. So in the end, the cost of the building came in at £40,000. And the government was so embarrassed by this that this is the only building, as big as it is, that was opened without fanfare. They just wanted to avoid attention, which was very difficult with a building this size, and they just started to move in the ministries without any fanfare. It didn't have its official opening until 1996, when the building was renovated and rededicated and opened. Now, the coat of arms you see up there is reportedly the best and the biggest left in the country. Now, there's the personal coat of arms of Queen Victoria, which was also the coat of arms of the government of the UK. It's in its original colours, and you will see it has a unicorn and a lion, and they're called supporters. The lion rules with might, and the unicorn rules with harmony. And they came about in 1603 when James VI of Scotland took over the throne from Elizabeth I. But that's another story. When we come down from the coat of arms, we will see the clock. Now, this is the oldest civic clock left in the country, and that was installed in 1876, made by a company in Croydon, London, and cost £94 and was shipped out in 1876. It works on the pendulum and weight system, which requires it to be wound every 7 days. If it's not wound, then the weights, which have a combined weight of 200 kg, will end up in the dirt in the basement. So we try to avoid that by making sure it's wound every 7 days. When it was first installed, and in later years, to keep the time correct, up on Mount Victoria is an old cannon, which you can still see today. That was fired at 1 p.m. every afternoon. The men on the cannon used to wait until the time ball at the observatory fell, and then they would ignite it, and it would boom out over the city, and then everyone set their clocks by it. Even today, people still rely on the clock, especially on a Sunday morning when they lay in. If the chimes are not on time, Monday morning you can be sure there'd be a phone call from the people, the locals. So people are still listening out for the clock, even after all this time. And may I add that it's been now ringing out for 144 years. Now, earlier on I mentioned that it was made from timber. The majority is kauri. Now, there was 2,050 cubic metres of kauri used. In fact, a small forest in Northland was cut down and barged down to this site to construct this building. But the actual structure, the studs and the dwangs, are made from Tasmanian hardwood. Now, Clayton knew what he was doing. It caused a bit of a storm when they brought in the Tasmanian hardwood. The local sawmillers saw this as an affront when they could have supplied it. But Clayton knew what he was doing. It's a hard timber, it's sturdy, and when you've got four stories, which by the way is about the highest you can go with timber before the bottom plate becomes crushed. So by using Tasmanian hardwood, it was better, it was stronger to withstand the weight, especially on the bottom plates. The building was originally lit by gas from 1876 to 1895. And then they decided to cut the gas and install electricity. There is still in the building, in fact, one gas lamp, which is symbolic, and that's in the main foyer as you come in through the main entrance. Sadly, the lamplighter lost his job. He wasn't required anymore. And when you're outside and you look at the gas lamps, you'll see steel bars coming out from the lamps. And it was there that the lamplighter placed his ladder so he could climb to light the lamps. So that passed into history and the building was electric. We are now in one of the exhibit rooms, which are open to the public. And at the moment, we have an exhibition of women's suffrage, which goes back to 1893. One thing I want to point out in particular is the bust of Sir John Hall, who was Prime Minister from 1879. He was known as the Ladies' Apostle. He was in favour of women's suffrage and helped get it through Parliament. The bust is on loan from Parliamentary Services across the road, and the poor fella was a subject of abuse in 1963. A young man came into the Parliamentary building with a crowbar and set about smacking the busts. They don't quite know why he did it, but he did it. And so poor Sir John Hall has now a chipped nose and a chipped ear. Here we are on the northern staircase. This was designed by Clayton, and in my opinion, one of his greatest works. It's called the hanging staircase, and he tried to make it look like it wasn't supported by anything. In theory, it's good. But unfortunately, over the years, the staircase started to drop. So they had to put props in place. They've gone now because of modern technology. We've been able to support them. But when it came to renovating the staircase, they found it had dropped by 250 millimetres. So they had to jack it up back into its original position. This took 2 weeks, millimetres per day, to get it back up into its original position. We also have one on the southern end of the building. Now, because of the staircase sinking, they were worried about the loading. So as late as 1985, it was forbidden to run on the stairs. Now, here we are on the ground floor of the southern end of the old government buildings. And behind me is the birdcage lift. Now, it's the last of its kind in the country, the birdcage lift. And the reason this was kept was because it's got some historical significance. It was built in 1921, and its purpose was to move the veterans from the First World War, who had lost limbs, legs, arms, up to the second floor, where the office for rehabilitation of the soldiers was situated. It's suspected that the real purpose for the lift was for the ministers who were getting on in age and were tired of climbing the stairs. It was run by an ex-serviceman until 1940, when they went automatic with it. Now, when it came to protecting the government's books and the government's gold, they were housed in the vault. Now, there were two vaults, both four stories high, one in the north wing and one in the south wing. The vault itself was divided into two with steel bars. On one side was the day-to-day pigeonholing of documents, and on the other side was where they kept the government books and the gold. They weren't so much worried about theft, they were worried about fire. And the vaults themselves were 600 mil thick. So hopefully, if there was a fire, this would protect the documents and the books, because remember, there was only one copy. They couldn't download a second copy. So it was vital that they protected them, the government books, a record of what was going on. Lose that and you've lost everything. Like most wooden buildings of the day, like most cities of the world, you'll always find rats. They go with us hand in hand. Even today, in a modern building, there'll be rats in the basement. This building was no exception. In fact, it was overrun with rats. So to counter this, to try and keep the population down, each department was given a cat, and to go with that was a milk allowance to feed the cat. And at night when the building was locked up, the cats were released. And by all accounts, they were very good at keeping the population of the rats down. Today, we don't have that problem. You might find one or two in the basement, but we don't have them as they did in the day back in 1876. Their greatest fear was fire. At one stage, the caretaker actually lived on the premises, and his sole job after the building closed at night was to go around on the lookout for any fires that could have occurred. Fortunately for us, this never occurred, as the building is still here today, and hopefully for another 100 years. Today, it's leased by the Law Faculty of Victoria University, who have leased it for 50 years until about 2036. They're very good caretakers, and in fact, they add dignity to the building. As you enter the grounds of old government building, you'll come across a bronze statue, and that statue is of Peter Fraser, a wartime prime minister. He became prime minister in 1939 and went through till after the war, 1950. Now, Peter came to New Zealand when he was around about 26 years of age, and he worked on the waterfront and various other odd jobs until he got into politics. Now, he helped form the Labour Party in 1916 and went on from there. And in 1939, he became prime minister. Now, Peter had poor eyesight, and he's the only prime minister that had all these reports read to him because he was embarrassed by holding the paper too close. When you look at the statue, you'll see that he's leaning forward. And that's the memory people have of him leaning into the southerly on his way home.